mysteries abound around the world. From strange lights in the night sky to ghostly apparitions passing from one realm to the next. From the Great Pyramids of Egypt to what lies beneath the depths of Loch Ness. From Bigfoot to Atlantis, they are all mysteries waiting to be solved. Join Lori Phillips, Lauren Smith, Graz, and Billy Simmons as they search for the truth on Nightcallers Radio.
Welcome, everyone. It is February 5th, 2015. You are listening to Nightcallers Radio, as always, live and unscripted. My name is Lori Phillips, and I'm here tonight with Bill Simmons and Graz. And Miss Lauren is not here tonight. She had to work late tonight. So we're a motley crew tonight, but we're here. How you doing, guys? Did y'all ever get that chat going?
Yeah, up and running.
You kicked my butt out. My butt is no longer in there. Well, that's okay.
I'm sorry.
Well, I love you anyway, man. I love you, man.
Well, I'm glad you guys got that chat straightened out there. I didn't even know how to go in there and even start it up. Isn't that pitiful? So I was like, okay, let me look, trying to figure out how to do it. And then I saw that Graz was going to do it, so I had to go uncheck the box. And oh, far too complicated for me tonight.
That's okay. You've got too many irons in the fire as it is. Just keep your job. You're doing a wonderful job.
So how is everybody tonight? You guys doing okay?
Yeah, no complaints. I'm the sole survivor of the stomach flu outbreak here in this area. I think I'm the only one, knock on wood, that hadn't got it yet. But
yeah, well, it is going around, and it found its way to my house. I've been homesick all day, so but I'm going to be a trooper, and we're going to have a great show. We've got a great guest, and so it should be fantastic, as always. So, hey, any news, guys? Any Bigfoot news, anybody?
I haven't heard anything. It's been dead on my end down here. I wish I had something new to report, but no.
Well, we were talking earlier about that swamp ape thing, that video.
Yeah, the Lettuce Lake video. Have you seen it, Bill?
No, I haven't.
It's over on Nightcaller's Facebook page. I sent it over there. I thought it was real interesting. Definitely need to go and check it out. Anyone that
you're giving it a little bit more thumbs up than I am. I'm kind of 50-50 on it.
Well, tell us what you really think, Graz.
Exactly.
I'm 50-50 on everything until somebody learns how to use a damn camera.
Yeah, he's saying they should have zoomed in. Right.
Well, that depends, too. A lot of people are using those phones anymore. They're just depending on their phones, and phones are worthless when it comes to real documentation. There's not much you can do with the darn things, but aim, point, shoot, and click, and everything, and okay, everything's done, and everybody's happy. Personally, I'm from the old country when you can actually zoom in and learn how to use a camera.
Yeah.
I don't know. I'm just an old fart. I'm a dinosaur. I can't help it.
I'm an old fart, too, but I thought it was very interesting footage. You know, I've actually seen Bigfoot move, and to me it moved very authentically, and also its appearance was very similar to what I've seen. And so I was quite intrigued by the footage. And but anybody out there that hasn't seen it, you can go over to Nightcaller's Bigfoot page, Nightcaller's Bigfoot Radio Facebook page, and it's on a link under Kipp Morrill's show advertisement. So if you go there, and well, I can already tell it's going to be a night for me. I'm going to just be all tongue-tied and ugh. Okay. Deep breath.
I'm just curious about that. Is that still picture related to the video somehow?
I don't know. No, two totally different subjects. Because I saw the still picture and I was going,
crap.
Oh, really? Yeah. I didn't buy that at all. But the other footage was, see, the still picture, the really funky looking Bigfoot standing in the water with his shoulders, you know, and head out of the water, that was like 2 weeks, came out 2 weeks before this Lettuce Lake footage came out. Two different areas entirely. So I don't, I think that's what is lending a lot of people are leaning towards hoax because of the other hoax. It's following on the heels of a hoax. So to me, I found it very compelling. Not to say that I think it's completely real. I'm not going to say that, but it was some good footage to me. So, I mean, you know, that's what I say.
Well, that's the only news I've seen that woke me up a little bit. 50-50 is a pretty good wake up. That's good enough for me.
Okay.
Well, I thought I was going to have something really good. I had a photo that was given to me. It taken about 2 to 3 miles from where I live. And, it looked, you know, it was on four legs going up the hill. But, you know, we were looking at it, Graz and I think worked on it about 2 hours and figured out it was a bear, which in the area that I live in is, you've got a better chance of seeing a squatch than you do a bear.
Right,
I was real pumped up there for a little bit, you know. I thought and it was a real good picture. That was the thing, you know, you can't win them all. Like I said,
no,
bear
you can't.
One, I mean, that's
well, you got to look at them, you know, like the pig squatch we were looking at, and the one that everyone's still arguing about, that one owl picture that everyone's saying is a squatch and all that kind of stuff, and everyone's going to be debating on that one for the next 20 years, but you got to look at them.
That's
right. Was that one that they thought was a squatch, and it was a game camera picture. It turned out it was a crow. You remember that one?
Yes,
right.
I remember that one.
Yeah.
Going through a deer feeder or something like that.
Yeah. That's pretty interesting.
Oh, this one was only, what, Grass, 20 foot, maybe 25 foot away from the lens, from the camera. And, I mean, just phenomenal picture. But
and it was a damn skinny bear at that. And
that's
what threw you off.
I had never
Yeah, it didn't
seen
really look
bear
like
that
a bear.
Skinny.
Right.
You're
but
sure it was a bear?
Yeah, Grass found a picture on the net somewhere of the world's second skinniest bear compared it to. So.
And it was a Texas bear, so that worked out.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's the news for tonight. Thank you again. Come again.
Hey, that was great. That was great. Well, I am ready to bring on our guest. So, if Graf, if you will graciously introduce our guest, we'll bring him
How
on.
How gracious I am. How gracious I am. Well, Nightcaller's Bigfoot Radio presents California Bigfoot researcher Kipp Morrill. Nightcaller's. Kipp was born in Redding, California in the late 60s. No exact date, that's pretty good. And by the time he was in grade school, he was already interested in the Bigfoot phenomena. By the age of 7, He owned several John Green books and was hooked. It wasn't until the advent of Facebook that reignited the spark. After joining several groups, he began to get to know more about who was involved in the research and where. His first expedition was an invite by Bart Gattino, where he was invited to assist with the recreation of Bart's famous Sierra site thermal footage. Since then, he has been fortunate enough to meet many solid and respected researchers and feels fortunate to often be included in their research. Kipp refers to himself as more of an enthusiast than a researcher, but truly enjoys being part of the team when out on any expedition. Kipp has been a federal wildlife firefighter for over 20 years and is currently a program manager for a federal land management agency. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Grav.
Don't mind me, I had to get by some typos there.
Oh, it's my fault. I got it kind of late in the game, and I put it up, and there you are. You've got to learn to read between the lines.
Yes, ma'am.
Anyway, welcome, Kipp.
Well, hey, good evening.
Good evening.
And
how
I
are
will,
you
I will. I'm doing great. I will take full responsibility for those typos. I kind of typed that out with my fat thumbs one evening when I got back in from out in the field, and so that was my fault. But I thought that it was read very well. So thank you for that.
Well, yes, I'll have to have a conversation with our editor after the show.
That would be moi.
Bad case of copy paste, dear. That's okay. We love you anyway.
What have you been up to today? Yeah, I think you were telling us about it earlier. So,
I am. I'm actually involved in with as my bio said, I'm involved with a federal land management agency, and I'll be somewhat vague just because I like to do that. But I'm involved in aviation management, and I was actually down in Southern California helping with an unmanned aviation project that was documenting the campsites that they had down in the desert for during the Second World War for training troops to go over and fight in North Africa. And so it was very interesting. They used an unmanned aerial system to document, I think it was 9 square miles in 3 days, and took something like 27,000 images with 2-centimeter resolution, which is just amazing. And so you could actually see the tank tracks, some of the places where the tanks were used, and some of the trails and some of the old pathways and actual tent sites and some other anomalies that are out there. So it was something that the archaeologists down in that area wanted to document, and this was, you know, just a great way to do it. It was fairly cost-effective. Obviously, if you're going to fly a manned aircraft at low altitudes, you're starting to get into that dead man's curve. This keeps the risk down and a tremendous amount of data. So it was very interesting.
Wow. And so you drove back today from that area, I presume. What, didn't you say it was an 8-hour trip?
Yeah, it was a long one. I got up about 4:30 this morning and hit the road a little before 6, and I won't lie. Right before I called in, I went over and got a 4-shot coffee from Starbucks. So I'm going to be plenty awake, and if I start talking a little too fast, then you'll have to just slow me down.
We could all use some of that ourselves, I think.
I think
pass
so,
it around,
yes.
So.
Yeah. I've got decaf over here, and I don't think it's going to cut it, but we're going to try it for a while.
You got the unleaded. I got the regular.
There you go.
I think you got the high octane, 4 shots. Okay, well, we can see by your by the description that you were interested in at a very young age. Okay, how in the world did you get interested at such a young age? Did you see something on TV, or is that how it all began?
So living in Reading, growing up there, my family had some friends that owned a resort up in Trinity County, a place on Lewiston Lake. Of course, being in Trinity County, there were many sighting reports, and I believe it was being up there and hearing some of the different stories of some of the sightings, and it really intrigued me, the fact that there could be something so mysterious and large living in the woods. Of course, being 6 and 7 years old, thinking about, something like that, it scared me to death, but
of course,
it was intriguing. And so, so my parents were really good about, if I was interested in something, feeding that interest. And so the lone bookstore in Reading downtown had the John Green books, and so, which I have two of them still. I had, I think it was The Year of the Sasquatch. I'm trying to think of the different names, but nonetheless, I purchased those books and I read them cover to cover to cover. And I think that it was just extra intriguing because it was right in my backyard. And so it was something that seemed plausible. So anytime we were driving back at night or driving up there at night, constantly staying awake and paying attention in case I could see something. And so it just, it really fed that, that adventure spirit in a young kid. So,
but it was many years later before you actually started getting involved with different groups and learning, communicating with other people about the subject?
Yeah, I started, obviously, Facebook is an incredible tool, and there's a lot of stuff out there. Excuse me, and I was fortunate enough to get to know Bart Catino a little bit through Facebook, and there was a Bigfoot, Bay Area Bigfoot group that was being put together, and he suggested and kind of vouched for me, said that, he's a wildland firefighter. He's an outdoors person. And basically told Tom Yamarone that, hey, this guy's okay. He should join the group. And so with that, I came down, I think it was every other Sunday or one Sunday a month, they had meetings down in the Bay Area near San Francisco. And so it was about a 3-hour drive one way, and I would drive 3 hours down. I would go to the meeting, and I would drive 3 hours back. But it was important to me. I really wanted to get to know people, and I wanted to see what kind of research was being done. And so it was a great experience. I met some just fantastic people. Tommy Amarone, of course, who's just what an incredible individual he is, and a fountain of knowledge when it comes to Bigfooting history and research. I met Jerry Hine there, and the late Joyce Kern, who's just a wonderful woman, and some others. But that kind of started it out for me in getting me back involved. And it was then maybe about, I think it was that summer, I had been invited to go to Bumping Lake with Bart Catino and several other folks. And I had gotten a call right before that from Bart saying, we're not going to Bumping Lake. And of course I was devastated. I thought, oh gosh, I've always wanted to, this has been my first expedition. And he said, actually, we've gotten some thermal footage and we're going to go back up to the Sierras and we're going to research that area and actually do the recreation. And I'd like to invite you to come along with that. And so I was just extremely fortunate to go along. And there I was with Bart Catino and Roe Sahibi. I was with Justin Smea. I was with just a whole bunch. Wally Herson was there. I got to meet Wally. So it was just a really interesting group of people. And so I've just been fortunate, I guess, to be at the right place at the right time and gotten to know some really fantastic individuals. So,
was there camping out involved? I mean, did you stay for several days or was it just a one-day thing? Or?
No,
oh,
it's way up and it's actually kind of an area that it's kind of borders the Tahoe National Forest and the Plumas National Forest, and it's fairly remote. And so I packed up my stuff, and I think we were up there for probably 5 or 6 days, something like that, up in that area. And so a lot of camping involved, but it was a great time. Just had like I said, it was just getting to know some of these people that have been involved in the Sasquatch research for a long time. Of course, you know, there was some interesting, I guess, controversy. You know, I got to meet Justin, and Justin's the guy that that the Bigfoot world loves to hate. So I got to meet him, and he's, and I count him as a friend of mine now, and
right,
Justin's a good
right.
man. So it was interesting.
Well, I pretty much stay out of all the controversy, so I'm really not up to date on what's going on. But I've been learning. I've been finding out things, you know, as I go. Some people will inform me of this and that. But I had heard about your friend Justin, so.
Yeah, there's no, there's really no drama in the Bigfoot world.
No.
No,
no.
I don't know what they do if they didn't have the, you know, like those magazines along the shopping checkout. It's pretty much along the same line as Bigfoot. Let's see, what else can we make up this month and throw at each other and stab each other in the back? That's always fun.
I made the comment that I was going to put together an Excel spreadsheet so I could keep track of who wasn't friends with who, but who was back being friends with, and okay,
yeah.
This Bigfoot researcher thinks this one's crazy, and this one thinks this one's crazy, but everybody else thinks we're crazy, so.
Yeah, how many degrees out is every squatcher from everybody else's squatcher? Okay, then you can go into which group broke up, and then how many members went over and started their own group over here and yelling at somebody else, blah, blah, blah. Let's go back.
Oh, up. Goodness. What is it I said? I think I made a post in the Squatcher's Lounge once that said, you know, this Bigfoot group, people are so cutthroat and mean. I said, this would never happen in my leprechaun or unicorn group. So
actually, it probably does, because the same kind of thing happens with UFO enthusiasts, ghost hunters. Mm-hmm. It's just, I don't know if it's professional jealousy. I wouldn't know how to describe it, but you're just dealing with so many different personalities, so many different levels of the Bigfoot research, where people are at different levels and different beliefs, and some people are very territorial about what they have and know, and are you know, don't want to share it, and that causes problems because somebody talks out of turn, and then it's a mess. So
yeah, you know, and I find it so interesting in that, you know, I like to think that. I'm a straddler, if there is such a thing. You know, you have the flesh and blood group that says, you know, it's a flesh and blood animal. This is what it is. And then you have, I guess, what some people would call the spiritual Bigfooters or the woo groups.
Woo-hoo.
And
yeah,
you know, and I'm
we
I
call
like
them
look,
the fringe element. We call them the fringers.
Yeah,
the fringers.
And I'm
yeah.
friends with both of those groups, and. I would probably tend to lean towards the flesh and blood camp a little bit more, but I think the most intriguing thing is the fact that we don't know what we don't know. And you know, these different sightings and these experiences that people have are very personal. And so it's hard for me to tell somebody, you didn't experience this, or I think that you didn't experience this, when, you know, it's hard to say. It's hard for me to wrap my head around something that might have been more spiritual or more of that type of an experience, but I don't know. I wasn't there. I just.
And, but that's the only problem. It's subjective. And
it
there's no way you can quantify the situation. You can't put it on paper. You can't put it on film. So it, in my view, I can only put that into a file, and that's I would say pretty much all you can do.
You know, some people, and at the risk of sounding East Texas, some people get plumb mad about it and throw their hat down and say, that's a bunch of BS. And I mean, they just really, it just gets all over them if it's not flesh and blood. And I can understand how they feel about it, but at the same time, I'm probably the most open-minded of a lot of people I know, and I try to, I'm kind of like you, Kip. I kind of keep an open mind you know, I've had things people have told me, and I was just like shaking my head and looking at them sideways, put up on the shelf, and 3 years down the line, I see it for myself. So you just never know.
I think if people were to focus more on, I guess, on the thrill and the mystery and just revel in that as opposed to becoming territorial and angry about things, I think there are a lot of people that become angry because they feel like the one group takes away from the credibility of the other group or discounts what the other group is saying. And, you know, I think that, you know, if we all find that common ground, for lack of a better term, can't we just all get along? But, you know, if we have the ability to, you know, the focus on some of the things that are similar, which, you know, for me, the only reason that I'm involved in Bigfooting, the only reason is because it's fun. If it wasn't fun, I wouldn't be involved in it. And for me, it's like fishing. You know, if you go fishing, only time you have fun fishing is if you catch fish. You probably ought to go and find another hobby because that's probably not the one for you. But for me, Bigfooting is like fishing. It is an incredible opportunity to go out and spend time in the woods with people that I enjoy being around and having a good time with and laughing with. And if there's an experience or something happens, you know, we're going to engage in research. We're going to go out. We're going to do things. We're going to try and have that experience. But if it doesn't happen and I go home, you know what? I got to sit around a campfire with some great friends and had a good time, and I'll look forward to doing it again. So the Bigfooting for me is a huge excuse to just get out in the woods.
You know, that is a great way of putting it, too, because that is what it's all about. And another thing, too, is respect. If you have respect for everybody out there, then, you know, a lot of people just feel, I think, that they're not respected. And so that's where hard feelings come into play and people just start getting bent. And as long as you show a respect to everyone out there, that's the most important thing. But getting back to your trip up in the Sierras, and you were up there for 5 days, did you have any activity while you were up there?
On that trip, I would have to say no. I don't think that there was any activity. It was interesting because, you know, the thermal footing that occurred, and one notable name that I left out, which I was on another show not too long ago, and I realized I went, oh, I forgot to mention so-and-so. And but one major player that was up there as well, because he's not on Facebook, he doesn't engage in the social media, but he's a solid researcher, Robert Leiterman. I don't know if any of you have heard of him, but he was up there. And that was the first time that I met Robert. And he is a methodical researcher. And, you know, he has a law enforcement background. And I remember we all met down at this particular place where everybody kind of gaggled up and we talked about where we were going. We were going to kind of caravan into this place. And I'd never met Robert before. Robert came out of his vehicle, walked over and started talking to Bart. And basically Bart told him, Robert, here's the deal. I want you to take my evidence. I want you to destroy it. Do whatever you need to do. Find holes, punch holes, do whatever you need to do. But if you can, destroy my evidence. And Robert said, okay. And that's what we did for the next 5 days or so, was just measurements and doing thermal recreations at night and looking at things in the daylight and those types of things. But we didn't have any experience. But I don't think, you know, we had a smaller group that went up there at another time, and there has been some interesting occurrences, but we had a large number of people, and we were spread out. And one of the theories was that when this last time, or when this footage occurred, it was a smaller group. It was fairly restricted to one area. They had a campfire, and everybody, all the few people that were there were around the campfire, except for Bart and Sean, who went to take a walk with the thermal imaging camera at about 1 o'clock in the morning. But aside from that, everybody's pretty much gathered around this one little area. So the one thing that may have changed when we went back up to do the recreation was there was a greater number of people, and we were spread out. So you had the one area where there was a campfire before, but then you had a smaller group that was maybe another 100 yards away, camped in the trees, and then another group that was kind of camped out in the meadow. And so the theory was that perhaps that we had just kind of made ourselves, set ourselves up to where we didn't give them the opportunity to be able to have the high ground and to be able to come in and see things. I don't know if that makes sense, but
Yes, it does. But, you know, it is pretty well known that if there is a large group of people there, it's very unlikely you're going to have a lot of activity. They, I think, are intimidated by large groups. And so can you tell us about another time, perhaps, that you did have some activity? Got to experience for the very first time the possibility that Sasquatch was close.
Well, it was interesting. We were up there at another time, and being a firefighter, knowing that we were up there during the summer, the folks that I go out with are very respectful of the fact that if there's fire restrictions and we can't have a campfire, and we didn't have a campfire, but it was pitch dark, and it was, and this is the same area. So this would be, we were gathered around where the campfire would have been, but there was no campfire. And it was a summer night. It was probably, again, about 1 o'clock in the morning. And literally right behind, up the hill, right behind where we were sitting. And I think that Kirk Brandenburg actually had it on a recorder. One solid wood knock right behind us. And I stopped and I said, "Did you hear that?" He said, "Yeah," and I had the recorder on. And it was literally, there was nothing else it could have meant. You know, people will say, "Oh, yeah, no. It was, you know, it was a branch that fell," or, you know, "It was somebody is up there," or whatever it might be. And I'm here to tell you, it was something with a stick, because it was a wood-on-wood sound, and it was one solid knock, and that was it. And, of course, Kirk has a thermal imaging camera, so does Bart. Didn't see anything up there. But, interesting enough, is that when Bart had his thermal footage, had he not literally looked, we called it the gap. If he hadn't shot the gap, this one particular gap that looked down towards the camp, if he wouldn't, and there were these, basically it's kind of a dog-haired thicket of young pine trees along the side of the road as they wrapped up around the camp. But there was this one gap. And he just happened to look down, saw some sort of just a little bit of a heat signature, and immediately thought that he was looking at, of course, the people that were in the camp, but realized that was more to the left. But the point is that had he not looked right at that right time, right down that gap, and just happened to see the images, he wouldn't have known they were there. Nobody would have known they were there. And so
right. It
just seems like, obviously, if they've learned to exist and be that elusive, then they've probably adapted to learning how to hide behind trees. I guess it seems to make sense that that's a logical, some sort of a learned survival technique or some sort of a learned behavior. If I'm behind this, they're not going to see me. Or if I stand still enough, they'll probably just go by and they're not going to know that I'm there. So I think it's highly likely and possible that even though they looked up the hill and up behind us with the thermal camera, you know, if it's a big enough tree and they're going to stand behind it, it's very possible that whatever it was ducked behind a tree.
It's probably worked 100 times before for them.
Well, that thermal,
that
thermal video, and they were in kind of the Bigfoot were in kind of a precarious position being between Bart and the camp. If I'm looking at the map right now, and Bart was down on the other side of that dog leg above,
yep,
or something, wasn't it?
It was down below.
It was in between them.
Right. And it's interesting because, again, and I think this goes for a lot of Bigfoot research, a lot of sightings, a lot of different firsthand accounts. You know, everybody is comfortable being that armchair quarterback, saying, well, no, it had to be this, or they couldn't have done this because of this being here, or whatnot. And until you're actually on the site, until you're there, it clicks. It all makes sense. You know, everybody says, well, it was just those guys around the campfire. And that's the campfire was, you know, if you look at the map, the campfire was down and off to the left of where Bart was looking down. So that wasn't anybody. And, of course, you know, I've been around Rosa Heavey, and I've been around Todd Hale, and I know those guys. And I'm 6'3", and those guys aren't even close. And we basically found through the recreation that one of those bipedal subjects was between 6.5 and 7 feet tall, and the other one was probably 7.5 to 8 feet tall. So how they made that happen, and then, of course, people say, well, you know, those were, you know, some people that were up there, you know, tending to their marijuana gardens. And I said, yeah, well, you know, 6.5, 7 feet tall naked guys in the middle of the night wandering around somebody's camp. You know, I think the last thing I would do is do that, because I don't know who's got a gun and who doesn't. It's probably not I'm probably not going to run around the Sierras naked, at least, you know, around there. So.
What time of year was this, Kip?
I think Bart's sighting, I believe it was it August? Because I think we went up in September.
It says here, 8/25/2012.
Okay, yep. That's it.
I'm watching
the
video.
What would the weather have been like? Could it have been possible for some naked people to be running around out there, or was it too cool?
Where this was, when I went up to do the recreation at night, I had my large, my North Face down jacket on. So it was cold.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
You're
yeah.
sitting at about, I think you're sitting about 7,000 feet at that location.
And it was 12:48 a.m.? I don't know. But
It's getting cold. It cools off pretty good at night, especially you're starting to get into that late August, early September up there. You know, it's mm-hmm. you're still getting into 100 degree temperatures down in the valley, but when you're sitting at 7,000 feet, and that's a fairly dry, that particular site is probably, it's kind of a, I would call it more of a southeast aspect. It's dry up there. It's been very dry lately, but you know, it's the likelihood of having anybody up there in the middle of the night. It's a ways back there, and you're going to hear vehicles. It's a pretty good hump to walk back in there. I'm not saying that it's impossible, but what I'm saying is it's very unlikely that people would be, you know, 7 foot tall people not wearing clothes would be wandering around
exactly.
out there.
Exactly. I would be convinced that it was probably Sasquatch. Yes.
Well, and I think that I appreciate the way that Bart describes it. Bart has a tendency to, he's not your, everything that goes bump in the night to Bigfoot.
Right.
His reaction to that is, it's compelling evidence, it's not damning evidence. It's very
right.
compelling, but you'll hear him, he'll refer to, when he's talking to other people, he'll talk about the fact that these were bipedal subjects. That's what we know they were. We know from the thermal footage that whomever or whatever were bipedal subjects. Now, you know, I would probably put money down to say that they are some sort of Sasquatch or Bigfoot creature. That's what my belief is. I'm a believer.
Yeah.
But could I say definitively? No. But I'd put money down that it was.
Wow. That's still very exciting. What else have you done? Do you mind sharing with us?
You know, I've been fortunate enough to go up and be a part of the Bluff Creek camera project with Jamie Schmutmut, with Steven Streifert, with Rowdy Kelly, with I'm forgetting people here, Robert Leiderman, Jeffrey Kelly was up there, Wes Lossner, trying to think of who else. I'm going to forget names. But I've been, I was fortunate enough to go down and actually camp at Louse Camp. And when they were going to go down and reposition the cameras, this was last summer, and Louse Camp is just down from Bluff Creek. And so it's about from Louse Camp to the actual Bluff Creek site where the Patterson-Gimlin film was shot is about 4 miles up the creek. And there's a really nasty road that dives in and comes down, and you have to hike down about a mile to go down to the site. Or I went with Rowdy Kelly and with Robert Leiderman, and we did a creek hike. And we literally walked up the creek from Louse Camp up Bluff Creek, much mm-hmm. like Roger and Bob would have before they had
right.
the sighting, and looking at the different locations of where they believe that things, where they were camped and where the horse reared or whatnot. And so that was an exciting experience.
I bet it
actually,
was. I would give
well, just from a historical perspective and
yes.
being there and being with the individuals that helped kind of rediscover that site and bring it back out for people to appreciate was really, really neat.
The rediscovery is controversial.
Well, yeah,
MK Davis
it is
having
controversial.
An argument. There's other people having arguments about whether or not those were the actual sites. That was, what, about 3 years, 3 or 4 years ago, they went out and did a mapping project trying to find the actual site. Streifert,
right.
Spider-Man, and a few other people.
Yeah, and from everything that they've got from the different the anomalies that are still there, I'd have to say they pretty much nailed it. But I know there's controversy, but I would put money down that they've nailed it. Looking at all the research that they've done, and actually going down and having them walk me around and show me, okay, well that's where those trees were, that's that stump, and these are this is the gravel bar. You know, obviously things have changed dramatically over the years.
I was going to say they would. How long has it been? 40 years?
Oh yeah. Yeah.
You know, I mean, woods can change a lot in 40 years. I'm absolutely amazed they were even able to find the same place.
Well, I think it took them a lot of time. There were different researchers that had gone down and claimed, well, no, this is the spot. Well, no, this is the spot. But but these gentlemen literally spent weeks and months going down on their own time with measuring and photographs, and they've done some aerial. They've done just this amazing amount of research. And we talk about Bigfoot research. We talk about the different things that we're trying to prove. You know, whether it's a casted footprint or trying to get that picture or one of those things. And this was more, I think, just from a historical perspective, and it was just amazing the amount of time and effort that these folks put into it, and it's very scientific. It was just amazing.
There's a whole series of videos on the Bifro YouTube site. I watched every one of them. There's probably about 15 or so videos of them going through the motions.
Right, right. And I think they're going to try and string that all together and make a documentary type of a movie, I think, eventually. But that was just an amazing experience to go and do that. And then we went.
You're so lucky to get to go and do something like that.
Oh,
that is just
incredibly fortunate.
Yeah.
I was going to say you if there's any group in this country that anyone would want to join, it'd be Bart and Leiderman.
Yeah.
Well, I'll tell you, if you're talking about they're Bigfoot people. Yes, they're very interested in that, but you just can't you just can't meet anybody that's any nicer and just good people. And like I said, it's, you know, the Bigfooting, I do it because it's fun and I get to hang out in the woods with great people. And I, and these are interesting individuals, you know. Bart Contino, he's just a solid researcher. But, you know, this last trip that we took, it was, I think it was close to Thanksgiving. It was kind of that time period last year. And it was Leiderman and Rowdy and Steven came in for a little while. And Bart and I, we were over near Oreck up at the, I think it's the Elk Prairie. Kind of, it's up in the Redwoods National Park. And so Bart comes from a family of chefs. You know, his family owns the famous sardine factory in Monterey. And Bart can cook. And I tell you what, he can make a mean spaghetti sauce. And he knows I love his sauce. And so the last night that he and I were camped in the Redwoods before we went out in the field, he had a big thing of his sauce and made this, and boiled some pasta. And I sat there before we left and had about three big old plates full of his pasta and sauce. So, you know, it's funny. They're just interesting people, you know. And Robert has a law enforcement background and just retired from state parks. And they're just very interesting and neat people. And I've been extremely fortunate to meet them and become friends. And the Bigfooting thing is just the bonus part. So,
so have you ever had an experience with Sasquatch? That's why I have to ask you this. Have you ever seen one? Felt like one was watching you? Had an experience of being followed? Anything like that?
Well, this was several years ago, and my wife and I had decided to spend Thanksgiving, of all things, over near the coast, over near, trying to think, it's in southern Oregon, near the California border, Coos Bay. And one day we decided that we were going to go up to this particular, it's called the bomb site. So in the Second World War, the Japanese actually got close enough to the coast with a submarine and put, the, you know, had a small airplane that they put together on floats, and a pilot actually flew inland. And the idea was they're going to drop incendiary bombs and start forest fires and try and devastate the United States. Well, it was a good plan, but they decided that they were going to drop it in the southern Oregon coastal area, and they dropped it in a, basically in a rainforest. So it really didn't work very well. But there's a site where this actual bomb had been dropped. So we wanted to go up and visit that. And it's maybe 45 minutes to an hour drive outside of Coos Bay. And we took off, and it was a little drizzly, and it was a little cloudy. And we got in quite a ways. And then I noticed, I thought it was going to be a quicker trip. The gas gauge is getting a little bit low. And I thought, you know, I don't want to take any chances. So I pulled the trigger on basically turning around and going, heading back. So we're doubling back to the kind of the way that we were coming to go down. And we got down a place that we had already driven past. And it was an interesting thing because something yelled or screamed at us. And it was, I was barely just drove maybe less than 10 miles an hour on this logging road. And it took my brain a few seconds before it clicked that, you know, and it was, I mean, you could feel it and you could hear it, that something was screaming at us. And then literally the hair on the back of my neck stood up. And my wife, who's a wildlife biologist by trade, we looked at each other. We knew what it wasn't. We know what elk sound like. We know what other things sound like. And with the lung capacity, whatever this was, we don't know, and she didn't know. But it was interesting. I guess I can't say that it's actually a Bigfoot sighting, obviously, or a Bigfoot experience.
I know, but it was interesting.
But I don't know. I don't know what to put my money on one way or the other. It literally made the hair stand up in the back of your neck. And I think that anybody that's been in the woods, you know, we used to have a saying, even in firefighting, when we talk about when things go gunny sacks or when things go wrong, you know,
right.
I tell young firefighters, you know, listen to the hair on the back of your neck. If
mm-hmm.
it doesn't feel right, it's probably it's that intuition, it's that sixth sense, it's probably not right. And I had that. So for whatever it was, it made the hair stand up on the back of my neck, and it really made me uneasy. So it was very interesting. And it's funny also. So my wife is a wildlife biologist, been out in the woods and done a lot of different things in her career. And one of them was she's been involved in spotted owl surveys, which take place in the middle of nowhere at night, late at night. And it wasn't until she heard some of these different accounts of people talking about wood knocks, talking about tree destruction and some of those behaviors that we were sitting and talking one day. And she said she remembered being in the middle of nowhere on the last national forest doing some survey work. And it was about 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning again. And she heard this whack, whack. And she looked at her partner, and the first thing she said was, why is somebody out here chopping wood in the middle of the night in the middle of nowhere? And about 30 seconds later, half a minute later, a tree came down. So in putting the two and two together and listening and hearing some other accounts of behavior, it was one of those things where it kind of clicked, and she went, wow, well, that's weird. And that was, you know, 20 years later, looking at that situation. But I will say that my wife is a wildlife biologist, and she is not a believer. So we have that opposites attract thing. So she doesn't believe in Bigfoot. So she just, as a biologist, she doesn't, until there's a physical specimen, I don't think she's going to buy into it too well.
She's never been interested in going out with you and Bart?
She has at times, but it's funny because Bigfooting, that's my thing. And so typically it's, you go do your Bigfooting thing, okay. You go, and I'll stay home, and I'm going to do my thing. I'll do my hot tub soak, and you go play in the woods. So, typically. But I did have another, and it's not an experience of mine, but it was my cousin.
Before you go there, I just wanted to say that this has been several years ago, but it seems like I read a report or an account of a bomb area, like what you were talking about, and there was a sighting there.
In what area? I'm sorry?
In the bombed-out area that you were talking about. Where they had the sighting was an old bomb area that had been and it was out west. I wish I could remember the rest of it.
Well, and this particular site is on the it's in a national forest. It's near Coos Bay, and it's just, there's a memorial there, and that's what it's called, is the bomb site. So it's not a bombing range. It's just it's a place where this bomb was dropped, and they call it the bomb site.
Okay. Digger Dog wants to know, have you ever found tracks during your outings? We're going to get to your cousin's report here in a minute.
Oh, yeah. I haven't really found anything definitive. There have been tracks that have been found by friends of mine and other people that I've done research with, but I have yet to actually find a track. It's interesting. A lot of these places that we go, even in the Bluff Creek area, boy, it'd be hard to find a track. You'd have to be pretty lucky to find it in the right place. It's just the soil types. You know, I think that, you know, back in the 50s and 60s, when they were pushing these roads in some of these really remote areas and starting to log them, you know, you had this fresh soil disturbance, which made a perfect perfect place for these tracks to be found. And, of course, you know, these long trackways and whatnot. But you go up there now, and those roadbeds are hard. You know, I think some of the you get fairly lucky. Maybe after a rain or something, you might find some tracks. But I think you'd be hard-pressed to find good tracks. But not to say that it's impossible, because we're always looking. But but nonetheless, it's tough. And no, I have not seen it personally.
Okay. Well, continue about your cousin's experience.
My cousin. My cousin is my age. I'll be 47 here in a few days, actually.
Happy birthday, early.
Thank you very much. So she and I are about the same age. She works in the medical field down in Southern California. This would have been probably the early 80s. I think she would have been, you know, probably maybe 12, 13 years old, something of that time frame. She and my aunt were living in a place called the Onyx Mine. So this area is north of the town of Trona, California, and outside of Ridgecrest, California. And I'm sure that those names don't really mean much, but if I tell you Death Valley, that'll probably ring a bell for you.
So
this Onyx Mine, this is a very arid, dry area. The Onyx Mine is a kind of near the Tintic Mountain Range. So you have the Tintic Mountain Range that drops down into the Panamint Valley, and then you have another range of mountains, and on the other side of that is Death Valley. So it's Mojave Desert, basically. So they lived at this place called the Onyx Mine. My aunt worked in the gift shop, and my cousin was, of course, going to school. I think had to go all the way down into Trona to the high school there, to the school. But they had lived in a mobile home that was up towards the top of this hill, and there was a big water tower up on the top, and I think there were several residents there, not many people living there. But they would have a campfire at night once in a while and roast marshmallows and whatnot. And they got to know the local critters that would come in. They actually would leave food scraps, and they would see the coyotes, and the coyotes eventually bring in their pups, and they'd see the wild burros. And so they kind of got to know the sounds and the smells and the different things of the desert. It was very interesting. And they would leave, they had a burn barrel that they would leave garbage and whatnot in. And off and on, they would get this really putrid smell, which they thought must have been the garbage. They said, she said one night they were sitting out by their campfire, and from up behind the hill, they heard a whoop, and they stopped and looked at each other. And then on the other side, down below them, another whoop answered that one. And they thought, wow, they had never heard a sound like that in all the time they had lived there. And it was really kind of interesting. So I don't remember the time frame from when that happened, but one night my cousin was in bed asleep, and she said that my aunt came in and shook her awake and said, "Wake up, they're here." And my cousin said, she didn't know what she was talking about, but she got out of bed, and they went to the front room. And there's a big picture window that would have faced kind of up towards the top of the hill. And in this full moonlight, they peeked in the drapes, pulled back the drapes and peeked up there. And they're standing in the silhouette of the moon up by this water tower was this huge, giant figure. And they watched it, and they said that she said it went down and got a drink. And then it turned and it walked right down the hill and right in front of their trailer there, like a driveway, if you will, maybe 30 feet in front of the picture window there. This thing walked all the way down the hill, walked down onto that driveway, and started walking left to right to walk down towards this arroyo. And she said, all of a sudden it stopped and it turned. And it literally looked right at where they were peeking out through the Drake.
Oh, my goodness.
She said she saw facial features. She saw the, you know, the. She said that they noticed that the arms were lower than the knees. It had the, you know, the conical shaped head. They saw the nose, and she said it looked at them, and then it turned and it walked and down into the arroyo and it was gone. And my cousin retold this story for the first time, and I couldn't remember. And this was a couple of years ago around Christmas time, and she gets very emotional about it. It's a very personal experience for her, and she said that she said my life changed that day. She said when I realized that monsters were real, is what she said. And it's so intriguing to me because first of all, it's my cousin. I know my cousin. She has no reason to lie. She has no reason. She's not gaining any kind of notoriety or anything from having an experience like this. And it is very personal. And just, I think that, I think anybody could have an emotional reaction to something, even if it's a mistake and it was a bear or it was a this or it was that. Yeah. But to have that kind of a close-in sighting and to have, have that kind of a reaction and whatnot, I think she saw something, and I have no reason to doubt that that's what she saw.
That is an incredible encounter.
You say that was in Onyx, or in Onyx, California itself, the city of Onyx, or
no? It was a place called the Onyx Mine. I don't think it's there's people there anymore. I think it's been sold or something. But it would have been north of Trona, California. So if you look at if you find on the map, you find Ridgecrest, and you'll follow Ridgecrest out to Trona, and then Trona is north along the in the Panamint Valley, the mountain range to the west, which is the Tintics, I believe, is that mountain range, and it would have been up in there somewhere.
Okay, we are going to stop right here and go to intermission, and everyone have a nice break, and we'll be back in about 7 minutes. We'll see y'all then.
You are listening to Nightcaller Bigfoot Radio.
Finlandia, Vita, Spain. But I kinda like the music. See, the ladies are insane there, and they sure know how to use it. They don't abuse it, never gonna lose it. I can't refuse it. Well, I've never been to England, but I kinda like the people. Well, I get it for Las Vegas. Only made it out to Needles. Can you feel it? Must be real. Feel so good. Oh, feel so good. Well, I never been to heaven, but I've been to Oklahoma. Oh, they tell me I was born there, but I really don't remember. Yeah, no.
Here in Seattle, that's right now.
I like me Danny Bonzo, better.
Me and Bonzo get a little confused sometimes. So, Kipp. Are you there, Kipp?
Yes, sir. I'm still here. Oh. I'm just hoping that I haven't put people to sleep yet.
Why would you put it? No. We'll wake things up a little bit.
Okay.
You're not, has anybody approached you about, I mean, you know, Barton, Leiterman, and Mr. Yammeron and stuff. Has anybody approached you yet about being a card-carrying B-Pro member?
No, actually. I know that one of the requirements of doing such would be to have to go on a BFRO expedition, which I think that, selfishly looking at it, saying that, you know, to spend $500 to go out so I could get that card. I probably, you know, it's funny because a lot of people, I think they begin their first experiences paying a great deal of money to go on one of these expeditions. Those are fantastic.
I've got a story about that.
Oh,
me and Mr. Moneymaker are having some issues.
Well, considering, you know, I'm not knocking it. I'm just saying that that's great. I think that I'm sure they get a great experience and they get to do some amazing things. But here I am, just lucky to have met all these people, and my first expedition was better than any BFR expedition, considering who I got to go out with and hang out with. And, you know, I'm sitting there with Bart Catino and Robert Leiderman and being a part of this team to investigate this thermal footage sighting. And here I am sitting at the campfire, you know, getting to know Wally Hursom and, you know, some of these people that, you know, I don't think there's probably a lot of people that have met Wally, have gotten an opportunity to sit down and just rap with Wally about the world and his, why he's involved with Bigfooting and the things that he does. And I don't know if I'll ever actually get invited to become a BFRO member. I think that it would be a neat experience, but I'm not ready to drop $500 to go out on an expedition at this point. It seems like it wouldn't be as worth as much now. So,
right. I would say that you've got the best part of the deal anyway, and as far as I'm concerned, you just went up a few notches on my rating system. anyone who actually wants to join BFRO doesn't really understand the whole situation anyway. A lot of people have been quitting lately because of some of the internal issues they're having with it. But anyway, so I think you're pretty much doing, you've got all the best with you right there in Southern California. You don't really need it. I was just curious whether you'd even thought about it.
You know, I think that the most interesting thing about being a BFRO member would be to have that access, that sighting investigation, to have a resource that says, hey, we got a call or we got an email from this individual who lives here who just had this sighting. Could you go and investigate it? And I think that's the huge benefit, is it's kind of a clearinghouse. It's one place where it's very well known. So, you know, I am a firm believer that we probably maybe get a tenth or a 20th of actual sightings reported, but those reports are probably going to be going to some place because of the notoriety of finding Bigfoot. They're going to get those reports, and then to be a beneficiary and be able to assist and get that sighting investigated, I think is probably a benefit. But that's the only thing.
Well,
it's
a double-edged sword, though. There is a double-edged sword to it. That is, if you have anything absolutely credible, then BFRO has a tendency to storm in with about 20 or 30 people and ruin the whole setup or situation anyway. This is just from what I have seen and heard, and I have not had to deal with it on a personal level myself. But this is just, you know, what I've seen and heard them do over a period. They even had, I think Matt put something together on the East Coast where they actually had 200 people tramping through the woods at one time. And I believe maybe he feels that more is always better or something. I'm not absolutely sure about that.
Well, you know, I've been fortunate enough in my profession, you know, working in a land management agency, I get to work with a variety of people in a variety of disciplines, whether they're archaeologists, whether they're biologists, whether they're other firefighters or something of that nature. And so I've kind of been getting a bit of a reputation, although I try and I keep my beliefs close to the vest, or at least I try. But I'll let it out once in a while when I have an opportunity, whether it's, you know, I was doing an incident commander type 3 assignment, and there was a fellow firefighter who was my trainee, and I said, yeah, you know, I got this hobby that I'm interested in, and yeah, it's kind of different, but well, tell me about it. What is it? And you know, I always get that sideways look, like, oh boy, do I really want to know? And then I said, well, you know, I actually, I believe in a yet to be identified North American bipedal primate. And they said, oh, Bigfoot?
Try to make it sound as good as possible.
Yeah, exactly. And it's funny because I get such varied reactions. So this particular individual, he looks at me and he goes, really? I said, yeah. He goes, oh, I totally believe in those. Oh, really? Well, and then the story comes out. Well, you know, I have this friend of mine that was this kid that was on the crew, and he was lived over in Hoopa, and he and his grandfather were fishing and on the Trinity River one night, and something was hucking 40 and 50 pound rocks into the river across from them. And Grandpa said, that's the hairy men, and they don't want us here, so we need to leave. And that was the story. And it's just funny because I've been able to prompt some of those stories. And a really good one was I was on a fire assignment 2 years ago, and I mentioned to one of the biologists, I said, yeah, you know, I have this belief. Well, about 3 months later, I got an email that said, you know, I understand you talked to so-and-so about your belief in this. We just took this report from this individual that had this sighting and gave me a kind of a location, and I sent something back and said, you know, would you mind if I passed along this contact information to somebody? And I knew exactly the perfect person. The individual that had this sighting report lived down in the Bay Area, and so I immediately called Tom Yamarone and said, Tom, is, you know, would you be interested in investigating this with this individual? And he did. So it's kind of neat that I've been able to kind of discreetly, and some people will laugh because they don't think that I'm all that discreet, but discreetly kind of allude to my hobby, if you will.
Well, so, you might get a hit on your security clearance sooner or later, but
that's right. Well, it was funny because I actually, because of this report, I got FOIA'd. So Freedom of Information Act, by an individual, and I won't say who, but I was dealing with different aviation issues, and I went in to talk to the law enforcement person that I was dealing with on some other aviation issues, and I sat down at the desk with this person, and he's a friend of mine, and I said, I just got FOIA'd, and because of this special interest hobby that I have. And he said, oh, really? What's that? And I said, well, it's Bigfooting. He goes, oh, really? He goes, my grandfather was into Bigfoot. And I said, oh, really? Well, where's your grandfather from? Oh, he's from Willow Creek area. My family's up from around there. And I said, oh, I said, that's interesting. I said, who's your grandfather? And he said, oh, he's been gone for many years, but his name was Gerald Crew.
Oh my God.
I said, your grandpa is Jerry Crew? He said, yeah. I said, you've got to be kidding me. But it's pretty funny how some of those, what a small world it is at times.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, Lord.
Oh. Well, I noticed that you do work on federal land. Not only are you a program manager, but also federal wildlife firefighter. I don't suppose there's any way that they've approached you about the possibility of Bigfoot being on federal land. The reason why I ask is I've always felt like our government knows about them in specific federal land where they may be habituating. So have you ever heard anything like that?
I haven't. And it's funny how often I get asked that question. And I'm trying to think of how to I don't want to sound disrespectful towards my other federal agency folks. But I guess people have asked me, do you think that there is some sort of a conspiracy to hide this phenomenon, this creature? And the only reaction I can have to that is, I don't think that there's enough, for lack of a better term, I don't want to say that people, because there's a lot of great people that I work with in the federal government, and we work very hard, but I don't know, a level of incompetence to be able to do something of that nature. Does that sounds bad? I just don't think it's possible. I think that there's so much bureaucracy that exists. I think that there's a lot of that exists that I don't personally think that there's any kind of conspiracy. I could be wrong. I don't believe there is any. I don't think there's any kind of disinformation campaign or anything like that that's going on. But it's interesting. I worked with an individual. I was on a special project, and there was an individual who was a biologist that worked at the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, the forensics, the wildlife forensics lab in Ashland. And I asked him, I said, do you believe in Bigfoot? You know, have you gotten any weird samples that have come through? And he basically said, no, there's no way. He said, I don't believe there's anything such thing. And there's two things that I could walk away from that with. I could say, wow, he's very definitive, and he says that there's nothing there. If I wanted to feel like there's maybe a conspiracy, I would think, well, he sure answered that awfully quick and was very aggressive about the fact that he didn't believe in it. So I don't know.
It's so incredible because I've had multiple sightings. I absolutely believe with all my heart they are real. They exist. They're flesh and blood. There are many of them out there. They're in every state. It's so when I actually encounter somebody who just really, such as this individual, really adamantly does not believe, it's hard to remember a time when I didn't believe, but there was a time that I didn't believe. I've only believed for the last 15 years. Before that, I absolutely did not believe in Bigfoot at all. I thought, you know, when someone brought it up, I would just laugh. I really did. Huh. And now look at me. So.
Well, and I think that I think that's an interesting. I think you fall into a knower, and we've had those conversations before where people have said, you know, are you a believer? I said, I'm a believer. I'm not a knower. I haven't had a definitive experience where I can say, yes, I'm a knower. But I've had friends and people that are close to me and people that I respect and a great deal who tell me that they're knowers. And so it makes me it adds to my belief of being a believer. But you're fortunate because you are a knower. You don't have to wonder if they exist. You know.
Right. I'm very blessed to have seen one. I wouldn't have thought that when I first did because it turned my whole life upside down for so many years. But now I think it's a blessing. It just took me a long time to accept it as a blessing because it does. It changes you completely. Whole life-changing event to actually see one.
It's interesting
maybe
you mentioned that. Because that sighting report that Tom Yamarone took from that individual, and this particular individual is a retired law enforcement officer. I think it was retired THP or something, and it was been on a camping trip, a backpacking trip up into the Golden Trout Wilderness. And then he watched this thing walk down a boulder field down to a lake in moonlight, not very far from he'd stepped out to use the bathroom and watched this thing. And that was the comment that he made was he felt that he was incredibly fortunate to have seen that. And I guess, you know, the same could be said for people that have been able to see a spirit bear or to see some piece of wildlife or something that's very rare. You know, you feel this fortunate blessing to be able to have had an experience like that. And so I think that's interesting. I hear a lot of that. I hear people feel that, well, you know, you're kind of in an exclusive club, if you will. Not a lot of people that have.
Well, you know, I have people say, so you've seen one? And I'll say yes. And they just kind of look at me like, it's like they immediately don't want to believe me because I've seen one. And then I feel like I know what I know what I know. And so I tell them about the experience. It doesn't matter to me if they believe me or not. They ask, I tell them. And generally, if they know me fairly well, then they usually believe me, I hope. But I don't know. But, Kipp, is there anything in particular you just want to talk about right now? I know we've been asking you questions, but is there anything in particular you really want to share with us today?
You know, I think I started kind of alluding to it. And one of the things was how easy it is for Bigfoot researchers to become armchair quarterbacks about other people's research and judging yes. other people's research and whatnot. And it's kind of almost like if you've ever...
We're grading everybody. We're grading and judging, yes.
If you've ever dealt with the media, you'll know exactly what I mean. If you've ever been interviewed by the media for, you know, whatever. You know, I've been interviewed many times by the media for, you know, for wildfires or something. And I'll be very specific and talk about a particular aspect of, like, my the operation that we're going in. And they walk away from it with something completely different, a complete different spin. And
yeah.
But I was there.
That
so
is the main reason why I would not be interviewed for I was asked to be on Mysterious Encounters, and other people were jumping up there and telling their story, and I said, I'm not. They're going to make me look like an idiot, you know. And sure enough, they were made to look like total idiots, like they had come out of the backwoods and were inbred and everything else. And the same way with another program that I was asked to be on. And I it wasn't that I didn't want to help and give a good story, but I knew they were going to mess it up. They put it in the best valuable, not the word I'm trying to think of, is the payment value they can get from your story. And that's what they tend to do with a lot of these shows. Go ahead, Kipp.
Well, and I think exactly. And you know the truth because you were there, and you know exactly what you were trying to say, but everybody else got a different message. And when you look at people's research, and I look at the Sierra site thermal footage, you know, is a great example. I've been there. I didn't experience it, but I helped to recreate it. And so I see, I've been on the site, so I see where things were. I see the measurements. I've seen all the aspects of what occurred. Yet, you know, people will sit back and very with very little information and say, well, it was just those guys that were, you know, from around the campfire that were walking up there getting wood. And
Hi.
Having been there and having been a part of that, I can say, no, that's not correct. But yet it continues to perpetuate itself because people sit there and throw rocks at the research.
And they don't know
and
how
guess,
thermal cameras work either.
And they don't know, and they're not familiar, and yet they'll sit back and they'll throw rocks. And I think that that's been a good lesson for me, and I hope for other researchers, is to, you know, really sit back and try not to armchair quarterback other people. You know, we get lots of fuzzy photos. We get lots of people with different experiences, and it's very easy to sit back and say, oh, well, then, you know, they were 2 miles outside of a town, or this couldn't have happened because of, you know, it was cloudy, or they only saw this. And I think it's a good message for researchers to really think hard before they judge other people's experiences and whatnot. I think we have a responsibility in the research community to ask good questions. And I think that people shouldn't be insulted or upset about being asked questions. I think it should be done respectfully, and I think it should be done in the context of trying to find the truth, and we should all be open with one another. But to sit back and call people liars or call people names and call them stupid or something, you know, I just think that we need to really, really sit back and think hard before we throw rocks at other researchers. And I think ultimately we want people to be open and honest and collaborative and cooperative with one another. And I think that if we had that respectful demeanor, I think it would go a long way in the community. I say the community. It's a pretty broken up community, but I think we all know what I'm talking about. So.
And it always has been. It always has been. I wouldn't know what to do if this community all rallied together and worked as a collective group. I doubt it'll ever happen. But I agree with you that there should be a lot more respect for what people, you know, I've seen pictures that people put up and, you know, the question is, why are all Bigfoot pictures fuzzy? Well, that's because Bigfoot is fuzzy. Didn't you know that?
That's right. Who knows? We don't know.
We're all searching for that fuzzy monster out there.
Right.
But the thing of it is I would see a picture and I totally did not buy into it at all. It looked like a shadow, or it looked like a bush or something in there. It did. Oh, can't you see it? Can't you see it? And I'm the world's worst. I can't see it. It has
blob
to be
squatch.
Plain as day. Yeah, it's a blob squatch. And I can't see it. I know, I can't. I would just hate it when people would send me pictures and say, can you see this great picture I got? And I'll say, I tell them right away, I'm no good at this. I'm really no good at this. I don't see other things that other people have just better eyes than I do. I don't know. But don't ask me to try to make an opinion. And so on Facebook, a lot of times people will put things up, and if I don't see anything, I don't get on there and say, well, I don't see anything. It looks, you know, blah, blah, blah. I don't tear it apart. I don't. I like people to come forward with what they find. I encourage that, but not everyone does. You know, some people will put something up, and they really feel proud that they captured that, and then they'll just be ripped apart. And I hate to see that. I don't understand it. And some of the people that are ripping them apart have never been out in the field. Never. That's their job, just to go around and be a troll. And
that is a really interesting, that's an interesting point, because what social media has done is it's given, and I want to say there's a positive and a negative to this, what I'm about to say, but, you know, social media has opened Bigfoot research to the masses. And there are a great number of people who sit behind a computer screen and do a lot of Bigfooting from there. And I'm the first to say that there's some valuable pieces to that, having those types of folks that don't, you know, that don't get out. Maybe they're just not physically capable. Maybe it's just they're not in an area where they can get out, whatever the reason might be, and I'm not trying to diminish from that, but there are a great number, because of social media, because of the anonymity of social media, that that will throw rocks and be not just impolite, not just rude, but downright cruel, downright disgusting, downright mean, and because of social media, they can enjoy this particular anonymity, as opposed to, you know, there's certain things, you know, I often said that in traffic, when people are in their cars, you know, they're very aggressive and they're flipping people off and they're yelling at people. But if you snapped your fingers and everybody's car went away for a second and everybody's standing there in the road, you wouldn't act the same way. If people,
no,
you know,
wouldn't.
So, and I think that Bigfooting is the same way, and you're absolutely right. There are a lot of people that, I don't know, I'm not a psychologist, I can't understand why, but they must have a great deal of time on their hands, that they can sit back and be cruel and be disgusting. And, you know, I often think, you know, kiss your mother with that mouth, really? Would you?
Yeah.
You know, your parents must be
it's
so
just,
proud of you.
It's just mean. It is just mean. I try to jump in and help as much as I can and support people. It's hard, though, because I have probably 750 Bigfoot researchers on my Facebook alone. And it is really, really hard for me to keep up with everything that's going on in all the different groups. I could, if I didn't hold down a full-time job, but then I wouldn't want the full-time job of trying to keep up with everybody and everything that happens. But so much stuff happens out there that I cannot understand it. There's not a maturity there.
You can't be
it. Yeah, it defeats the purpose that we're all trying to learn about that, this being.
And the other side of that is you have people that troll. You've got those people that are just horribly cruel and just uh-huh. downright mean. But then you also have the other side of it, which is people that are very sensitive to being questioned. And,
mm-hmm.
and as long as it's respectful and it's you know, I think that we need to question. That's what research is. We have to ask, well, are you sure you didn't see this? Or this looks like this to me. You know, maybe could you have, you know, whatever it might be, and just, you know, not to take those things personal. And I guess that's a good point. You know, it's like I tell people about my work. I said, I take my job and what I do very, very serious. I just don't take myself too serious. And I think that we could go a long way in Bigfoot research if we looked at it in such a way that, I take my research, I take what I do in Bigfooting and cryptozoology, I take that very serious. I just don't take myself too serious.
Well, that's very well said.
It's a hobby.
You know, yes.
That's
right. It is a hobby. For some, it is a hobby, but it's a little more than a hobby because most hobbies don't wreck marriages and most hobbies don't put people in the poorhouse or leave them stranded with a flat tire in some state. You know, I mean, these things happen to bona fide diehard researchers. it is just they become obsessed. And so it's more than a hobby to them. It is they're compelled to find the truth. But what I was going to say is that the longer you're in it, the more thick of a skin you get. And you don't really care if someone pummels you with questions or disbelieves you or anything else. You get a thicker skin. And some people never get that thick skin, and a lot of them just get out of it because it's just too tough. They don't like being ground up, and so they get out of it. And I hate to see
that. Begs a question.
Go ahead, Grant.
If you were out there one day and you had a really nice camera, nice video camera, and you knew how to use it, and all of a sudden there's a squatch about maybe 30 yards from you, just leaning up against a tree, and you brought that camera up and got really good footage, what would you do with that?
You know, I think that I would probably have a tendency to keep it well within a trusted group of people first. I think that I would probably, before I threw it out there for the masses, I would vet it. I would vet it through people that I trust and respect, and it would be, you know, one of the first people that I would call would probably be Robert Leiderman or Bart or Tom Yamarone, somebody, you know, some of those people that I know very well and that I trust that I could get a really good opinion on. You know, and I'd probably throw Adam Davies in that group. You know, Adam's a solid. The man's been all around the world and seen and heard things, and so you know, I'd want to get that opinion, that educated opinion. And at that point, if it were something that it seemed as though it were vetted and it seemed that it was worth sharing, I would share. I don't think that I'm definitely not one of those people that's looking to make a buck or looking to hide evidence. I want to get it out so that people would see what it was. But But no matter how good that picture is.
Anonymously, or would you stand up about it?
Oh, well, I would definitely stand up for it. I would definitely stand behind it and say, yeah, I can give you the facts of what I have, which was, you know, I filmed it here at this time, at this place, and this is what happened, and put it out there. And, of course, it doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter how unfuzzy the picture is. It doesn't matter how fantastic it is. There are going to be plenty of people that are going to think it's fake. It's a hoax. You're full of shit. Pardon me. But,
it's a PG-rated show, so that word flies in here. So
okay. Okay. Sorry, I let that one slip. But nonetheless, it's. I think it just doesn't matter. It's which kind of leads me to something else that I was going to mention, which was, I think ultimately, if we really want to solve this mystery, if that's really what we're in it for, we're going to need a physical specimen. Okay. And so does that mean that I condone shooting a Sasquatch? No. Does it mean that I'll vilify somebody that has made that decision? No. Personally, if I'm in the woods and I have a rifle and I have the ability and the option of shooting a Sasquatch, I wouldn't do it. I couldn't do it.
I wouldn't either.
It honestly, solving the mystery to me doesn't mean that much to me. I'm sure that really makes people scratch their heads, but for me, if solving the mystery means shooting and killing one, it doesn't mean that much to me. Personally, I could go the rest of my life believing what I believe and enjoying the hunt, if you will. I won't condone others who think that maybe that's the way that they need to do it. I know of people that have said that if I had the chance, I would do it. But
I know I've heard that too, especially down here in Texas, and it's just so disturbing to me. It's all about the hunt. They're hunting a wild animal, and I don't feel that that's what we're dealing with here. Exactly. So there's a lot more to the Sasquatch than being a wild animal. And
it is. Solving it doesn't mean that much to me. For me, I guess I enjoy the mystery. I want to have an experience.
Yeah.
I want
to
hear
totally
other people's experiences.
Totally relate to that. Totally. Yes.
But if I had somebody
exciting.
That I knew that shot yes. one and science was able to prove its existence, I wouldn't vilify that person. It's just my belief. There was a time in my young life when I was a big hunter. I was a deer hunter, and I was a waterfowl hunter, and I loved hunting. I'm not a hunter anymore, but I have lots of friends who hunt, and I don't have anything against them for hunting. For me, it's just, I don't have it in my heart anymore. I'm a different person than that now. And I'm not saying that they're bad people, but for me, solving the mystery doesn't mean that much to me.
Well, I agree. I remember back, do you remember Bigfoot Friday when, I think it was, Rick Dyer. I don't know I think it was Rick Dyer that came up with the Sasquatch in the freezer thing, and because it literally shut down the internet. And but I remember being so sad because I thought, this is it. It's all over. It was just a really sad time for me. I was so upset, not just because one had been killed, but because I felt like the mystery of it all, the intrigue and everything that I've been doing for the last 15 years well, at that time it was 12, 13 years. It was all for naught. I didn't want the search to be over. I love the search.
It's Christmas night.
Exactly.
You're 8 years old, and gosh, you put the Christmas tree up, and you watch the gifts go underneath, and by golly, you wake up on Christmas morning, and all the presents, you rip everything open, and then you realize it's over, and that's it. And I had a lot to look forward to, and now it's over. I guess it's almost like having that, it's like the day after Christmas, feeling or something, you know.
Well, we do have a question from the chat, and I'm not quite sure how to pronounce this gentleman's name, but Digger Dog wants to know, Kipp, do you believe that SMEGA, is that Smeja? Anyway.
Oh, Justin Smeja.
Yes. Do you think he actually shot the two Bigfoots?
I do.
Okay.
But what I will say is this. I can understand people questioning his story. And I've gotten hit across between the eyes on this several different times. So I know Justin. I've spent time with Justin in the woods. I've spent time around Justin as a family man. I've spent time with Justin. So I've gotten to know the man himself. And as I've gotten to know him, I feel like he has no reason to lie about anything that he's talking about. And when you talk to him and you talk to him about his story, I believe him. But I understand that you've never met him, if you've never spent time with him like I have.
If you don't mind, just kind of very quickly tell us the story, because I'm not sure I'm familiar with it, actually.
So Justin and a friend of his were bear hunting, and they were hunting out of a vehicle, and it was, I can't remember the time of the year, I think it was late in the season, it was bear season, and they went down a dirt road, a spur trail, and they went down towards the end, and he said that he saw what he thought was a bear, or it just didn't seem, he wasn't sure what he was seeing. He said it's staying on two legs and was waving its arms at him, and he shot it. He heard it go down, and then he heard it crashing through the brush, and they went to go find this thing, and then there were two small ones, and he said that they were menacing them, and he shot one of them and actually physically saw it, and it bled on his boots, and he watched it die, and they were freaked out, scared to death, didn't know what to do, tried to bury it, and knowing that they had shot, made some shots there, knowing that there was the possibility that a game warden or somebody could come around, I guess they'd seen one earlier, and they hightailed it out of the area, and not until posting on hunting forums or something, he started asking questions about what it could have been and what he saw, and I think that prompted some discussion and questions from other places. So basically,
where did this occur?
This would have been, I think, in 2011, something like that.
Wow.
So
I really
do
fly under the radar. I did not know. I've never heard this story. Can you believe it?
You never heard that story?
I have never heard this story. I know. Well, 2011, I was really, I think I was taking a break.
So this is Justin, and you could look this up, and I've probably bastardized the story a little bit.
So where did it happen again?
Up in the Sierras, up in, okay. near the in the Tahoe Plumas National Forest area. And so yeah, I believe Justin. Another part of that that helps me believe Justin is it's a hell of a coincidence to have Bart's thermal footage. It's completely unrelated, but it really makes what Justin's story, it helps to make that much more believable, having Bart's thermal footage right there. It's just too coincidental. It's too strange. It's too interesting that you could have something like that in the same place. I think what it does for me, having Justin's story without the thermal footage, which are completely unrelated, but having Justin's story without Bart's thermal footage, it makes it probably harder for me to put it all the pieces together. But, mm-hmm. but knowing Justin, having spent time with him, knowing him personally, having Bart's thermal footage in the same location, it really makes his story believable to me.
Well, the story went a little bit nuts after the initial breakout of the story, and then it went into things about samples being sent up to Derek Randall's and all this kind of stuff.
Yeah, and there's a lot of misinformation on that. You know, that
right.
the sample that was sent in, they knew it was probably going to be bear. It wasn't. So then when it came back and everyone said, "See, he shot a bear." No, you know what? They had a good idea that. Where they had found whatever that they, you know, that was buried in the snow. And there's bear hunters up there, and there's dead carcasses and things. And so when that did come back with that, coming back as a bear, I think that it wasn't a surprise, but everybody pointed the finger, see, this is what happened. So.
Oh, my goodness. Wow.
That's the hard part. The story was just, I mean, it's like it. Starting off with a circle, you tell one person, it's going to be changed by the time it comes back around to you.
Yeah, the grapevine effect.
Right.
Oh, my gosh.
Are we down
well,
to
we're down to 5 minutes. Less than 5 minutes, actually. Is there any advice that you would like to give to all the new researchers out there, the people that are just entering the field? And the new enthusiasts that are just taking part and getting interested in Bigfoot. Is there any advice that you could give them, Kip?
I would say, and this is just from me, keep an open mind. Be open-minded, but also be skeptical. Be very skeptical. Second guess yourself. I think one of the things that Bigfoot researchers get into that diminishes credibility is everything that goes bump in the night is a Bigfoot. Every call, every twig snap. You know, the thing is that 99.9% of the time, it's not going to be a Sasquatch or a Bigfoot. It is a deer or a bear or an owl or a this. Be very skeptical. I think be open-minded and make sure that, you know, you're vetting your experience. Don't deny your experience if you're having one, but ask lots of questions. Fall back to Occam's razor, which is, you know, the most basic logical explanation is often the explanation, but the only way to find that out for sure is to go out there, go out in the woods, get to know your research areas, learn what animals are out there, learn what times of year they're mating, doing their mating calls, or what time of the year they're feeding. Get to know your biology, get to know your ecosystem that you're working around, whether it's a desert ecosystem, forested ecosystem, whatever it might be. Just get to know your area, figure things out, get out there and spend lots of time in the woods and have fun. Don't make Bigfooting so serious. Don't take it serious, but don't take yourself so serious and mm-hmm. enjoy those experiences with your friends and your fellow researchers and just go have a good time.
Absolutely. Great advice. You've been a wonderful guest, Kipp, and you did not bore me in the least. I know you said, I don't think I'll be interesting enough. Well, I thought you were very interesting. And I thank you so much for coming on our show.
Thank you for inviting me. I had a great time.
I'm glad. I'm glad that you were wide awake. I never heard you yawn once.
After four shots of espresso,
I was going
to
say,
I had to slow myself down.
Oh, it was great having you on. We'd like to have you back sometime.
I would love to come back sometime.
That's okay. Yes, we'd definitely love to have you back. Right now, I need to go ahead and advertise for next week. So, Kipp, thank you for coming on. And we'll have you back sometime. And I will be sending you the link to the show as soon as I can get it downloaded and uploaded to YouTube. Will that be all right with you?
That sounds fantastic.
Okay. And I wanted to let everyone out there know that you can listen. Some people are having problems listening to Night Callers on Blog Talk Radio, but you can listen to it on our YouTube channel. I try to stay up and get that uploaded the same night as the show, so it makes it more convenient for everyone out there. Next week, we are having Dave McCullough from Massachusetts, and he has some recordings that he's going to share with us as well. So that is going to be a great show. But in the meantime, I want all of you to be safe out there, happy squatching, and everyone say good night.
Good night, everybody.
Good night, everyone.
And we'll roll that outro.